Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Aren't you glad for the grace that God gives us each and every day that we rise out of that bed? He gives us grace. He gives us faith for a new day. Amen? His grace is enough. Let's stand across this place as we begin our time of worship and singing. Let's sing it out.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God.
Sing it out.
Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough, heaven's reaching down to us, your grace is enough for me.
Great favor. Aren't you glad your chains are gone?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and light of blood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, unending love, amazing grace.
One of these days, this old world's gonna dissolve, and we'll see Him.
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Amen. And you may be seated this morning. It is good to welcome you to Olivet Baptist Church. Here at Olivet, we're all about loving God, belonging in community, making disciples, and reaching the world. And that was very much evident this past week. We want to take this opportunity to thank those that were involved this past Thursday with our food distribution. We had a great turnout, those of you that came to help, and we were able to bless our community. I think we gave away around 2,300 boxes of food to our community members, and we're going to be doing that again in October. But folks, this is the way that we can show and be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. And we just want to thank you for that awesome time that we shared together this past Thursday. I was so excited. Yes. There's nothing wrong with giving yourself a hand. And so don't forget, we'll be doing that again in October, and we'll have signups for that. So make sure you look for those. Also, coming up very soon, we're going to shift gears kind of a little bit this year, but we've done Boo on Broadway for the past several years. Last year we did it out at Case Park. Well, the association met, church association met and discussed how they would proceed with that. And this year it's going to be a drive-through situation where the families drive through and we as the church have booths and then we give the candy to them. So, what does that mean? Well, we need you to bring candy so we can bless our community. We've got the buckets out here that will be able, those individually wrapped pieces of candy. Start bringing those in so that we can start compiling what we need to have our booth for Boo at Case Park coming up. I don't know. Pastor likes Snickers. I'm sort of the oddball. I like Lemon Heads. That's my favorite. So we wouldn't turn down if any of those showed up in the office either. Hint, hint. No, but you seriously, go ahead while you're out and doing your shopping, grab a bag of candy to bring with you. The bucket will be out here in the foyer. You can just toss that in there, and we'll get all those put together for that event coming up in October. Also tonight, starting tonight, we'll have our D group test run. We'll begin at, are there different times? But just be in prayer for those groups that are going to begin those six-week test runs for our disciple groups. So that begins tonight. So pray for those folks as they begin and launch out this evening as well. Also, if you're visiting with us, we want to take this opportunity to say welcome. Fill out that visitor's form that's in front of you, and we have boxes that are beside each of our exits this morning. If you'll just place those in there that we may connect with you and so that we can serve you better as a church. And we just want to say welcome to you today as you've come to join us for our morning worship. Also, if you have prayer requests, we love to get prayer requests because we love church praying for your needs. And those blue cards that are in front of you, if you'll fill those out and place them in the offering boxes as well, we pray over those each week as a staff, and we want to know your prayers and petitions. We want to know how God is working to pray for you this week. Well, you know what? I just enjoy this time that we can come together and worship each week. I just get excited. I get up on Sunday mornings, and I'm just excited because I get to see you all. But I get to worship my Savior. And today we've been singing about God's merited grace, his unfavored grace, that he gives us that grace. But it's, you know what? It's because of the blood. It's because of the blood that washes us that we can stand before him and say, my chains are gone. So let's sing this great song together.
Oh. Of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, it washes white as snow. Oh,
stand as we continue to sing about the blood. As long as I have breath in my body, we'll sing about the blood of Jesus and how it covered us.
Oh, the blood, crimson love, price of life's demand, shameful sin placed on him, the whole Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Savior, Son, Holy One, slain so I can live. Oh, see the Lamb, the great I Am, who takes away my sin. The blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory.
Victory this morning, that we can stand before you forgiven, that our chains have fallen at the feet of the cross. And Father, when we stand on that judgment day, we claim the blood. We claim the blood that has covered us all. And Father, we thank you for that. We thank you for your sacrifice. It's in your name we do humbly, prayerfully pray this morning. Amen. Satan just cowers to think
come the power he lost when the cross had its day. Gone are the mornings when fear without warning would win and again have its way. Now when Satan reminds me of things I regret, I look to Calvary lest he forgets. High on a mountain of sorrow and shame, grace signed my pardon as Christ took the blame. When I'm called to answer for my history, answers for me. I am now under that beautiful wonder of grace that erased all my past. Feel the heartbeat of mercy inside me, and now I have found joy at last. I live in freedom, chains cannot bind, and I won't look back. Sorrow and shame, grace signed my pardon as Christ took the blame. When I'm called to answer for my story, Calvary answers for me.
Well, good morning. I tell you, it is good to see you here this morning. If you have your Bibles, if you would, please open them to Colossians chapter 1. All right. I like that excitement. Take your outline and place it right there. We're going to finish up our series this morning entitled The Most Important Thing. And our theme has really been the most important thing in the midst of all that's going on is for you and I to be right in the center of God's will, plan, and purpose for our life. It needs to be an intentional focus. And so as we think about that this morning, we're going to look at a passage from Colossians chapter 1. But as we begin, I want you to notice up on the screen. In fact, there's a picture that I want you to see up here because this is an interesting picture, because what you are seeing on the screen is something that NASA conceived it. In fact, it was expected to be the greatest achievement in the history of space exploration since landing on the moon. In fact, it cost nearly $4 billion, took more than 6,000 men and women over 10 years to finalize it. I mean, it is a brilliant idea. The interesting thing to me is look at it. It looks like it's wrapped in tinfoil, though, to me. I mean, for $4 billion, surely we could do something better than tinfoil, or it's just a whole lot of tinfoil. I don't know. But it has an interesting look. The goal was to place the most highly advanced telescope ever built in orbit, where it could basically collect data from high above the Earth's atmosphere. Scientists would be able to decipher light from distances of more than 20 million light years away. This has the most precise system of gyroscopes ever built, put together so the telescope could be precisely aimed at objects millions of miles away. So what happened was on April 24th, 1990, the Space Shuttle Discovery was launched with the purpose of placing this, which is the Hubble Space Telescope, into orbit 300 miles above the Earth. Now think about it. After all the years of hard labor, millions and millions of man hours, billions of dollars, the most expertise engineering that has ever been put together, what happened was thousands of people gathered around computer screens waiting for the first images from this telescope. But as they sat there expecting to get pictures from the edge of our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, what they realized was that it was absolutely blurry. They couldn't really see anything. In fact, they couldn't tell the Milky Way from a Snickers bar. I mean, it was absolutely a mess. In fact, what they discovered, think about this, the lens on the mirror of the telescope would not focus. It was discovered that the main mirror specifications were off 1/50th the width of a human hair. 1/50th the width of a human hair, and because of that, the telescope was useless. Now, what's interesting is it was fixed 3 years later. But 3 years, it sat there useless. Now, when I heard that story, I thought, you know, the truth is, I think sometimes we have the same experience when it comes to prayer, when it comes really trying to figure out and discover and live out the will of God. How many have things maybe you're praying about and you really want to know, man, this is, I want to know God's will. I want to know His plan, His purpose. I want to be right in the center of it. And yet you pray and you pray about something and you get no answer. It just doesn't seem to be clear. It's out of focus. Now, I would say the place to begin, if that's where you are, the first thing to begin to ask yourself, am I committed to the general will of God? In other words, am I living out the things that I know to do? I mean, doing these things that I know God's called me to do, because the truth is, you're never going to know the specific will of God until you are committed to living out the general will of God. Because if not, it's always going to be blurry. In fact, I continue to be amazed at the number of people who will say, man, I'm a disciple, I'm a follower of Jesus, but their faith is disconnected from almost every area of their life. Their faith is not a central issue in their marriage. It's not a central issue with their kids. It's not a central issue in their career. It's not an issue in how they manage their money. It's not an issue really in their relationships. How many kids who say, yeah, I'm a follower of Jesus, but they don't date like it. They don't talk like it. They don't act like it. People who'd say, yeah, man, I'm a disciple, but the word of God and the people of God and the purposes of God are not on their agenda. And then they wonder, why does it seem when I pray, why does it seem when I want to know what God's doing in my life, it's just blurry. I mean, I just can't seem to get it in focus. God just doesn't seem to be at work. Now, here's the point. If you're not committed to the will of God for your life, if it's not your desire really to live out God's will and plan and purpose, ultimately your prayers are going to be powerless, because every prayer that you and I pray, no matter how noble our motive may be, or great the goal may be, or how sincere the effort may be, every prayer that we pray should be focused on the will of God. God, what is your will, your plan? It's the key to powerful praying. God is so passionate about his will for you and for me that he not only wants us to perceive his will and to perform his will, he wants us to pray his will. In fact, notice this on your outline. 1 John chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. This is a good verse to put to memory, good passage. It says, this is the confidence we have before him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of him. Now, basically what he's saying here is that prayer, a prayer that is prayed in the will of God, is guaranteed to accomplish the work of God. You say, well, how do I really pray around the will of God? How do I begin to live it out? And and what I want us to do this morning is I want us to see a prayer that I think is an illustration of what John is talking about in the passage that we just read. In fact, it's in 1 Corinthians. It's in Colossians chapter 1, beginning here in verse 9. Notice what Paul says as he prays for the believers in Colossae. He says, for this reason also, since the day we heard this, we haven't stopped praying for you. We are asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, so that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. Right there is a picture of praying right in the center of God's will for your life. So I don't know what it is that may be on your heart. What is, I need God's plan. I want to know his purpose. Listen, here are some guidelines to praying and living out the will of God. Number one, you might write this down, I need to pray for spiritual clarity. I need to pray for spiritual clarity. Now, it's in John, 1 John chapter 5, the passage we read, he said we can have confidence in approaching God. Now, the word confidence there in the Greek has the idea of freedom of speech. So originally, for instance, it was a political term. It referred to the freedom to speak your mind in a public assembly. And so if your prayers are going to be effective, then they have to be free of your selfish desires. Free of, well, listen, this is just what I want. Free of, well, this is what I think I need. It is being willing to say, you know what, God, I want your will in any given circumstance. Not necessarily my plan, my agenda, not the way I see it. God, I trust you. I know who you are, so I want your will done. Jesus prayed, your kingdom come, your will be done. He said that's how we're to pray. In other words, we need to remember that the purpose of prayer is not to get our will done here on earth, but it's to get God's will done here on earth. And so when you go to God in prayer with this predetermination that you want his will, then you can go before him with unbelievable confidence, knowing that he's going to answer your prayer. Now, Paul illustrated it this way in verse 9. You might notice on your outline, he said, for this reason also, since the day we heard this, we haven't stopped praying for you. We are asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So what is he saying? We need to pray for the knowledge of God's will. So let me ask you, when you pray for others, how do you pray? You know, praying, God, help me to discern. Help me to have clarity of your will. If you're praying for your husband or your wife or your kids or your grand, Lord, help them have clarity about your will, the knowledge of his will. Praying for your spouse, praying for your kids, praying for your pastor, praying for our church, that we would have the knowledge of his will. There would be clarity. So prayer is not about getting God to listen to us, but it is basically, God, help us to listen to you. Now, what I've noticed, a lot of folks enter prayer and they really have one of three kind of agendas about it. The first one goes something like this. It is like, Lord, I want to take time to tell you my will because I need your help to get it done. Now, I want you to be honest with you. I mean, I got to confess this. A lot of times when I'm praying, here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, well, whether it's my kids or this circumstance or that circumstance, I'm thinking, okay, Lord, this is what you need to do here. I mean, you know, this is what needs to happen in that person's life. This is what needs to happen in my marriage. This is what needs to happen with my kids. And so, Lord, I'm going to talk to you because I want to make sure that you get it done, right? They don't ever do that here. Y'all are a lot more spiritual than me. You know, I mean, what it is, I have my plan, and then I really want to get God to at work to accomplish my plan. And then some people, it goes further than that. God, I really don't like your will, so I'm really going to pray that you would change your mind. I'm going to pray that you might want what I want instead of knowing what you want. And basically, Paul's saying, listen, if that's your agenda, you're going to miss it. You know, real prayer is, Lord, I want to know your will. I want to know what you want. I mean, it may not be, I may have a plan for my children, but God, you've got a greater plan. And I may have a plan for my marriage, but your plan is greater. I may have a plan for this circumstance, but your plan is greater. And let me tell you what happens. When your heart comes to the place that you fully surrender to God, listen, I want your will. Get ready because God's going to be at work in your life in a significant way. George Mueller, who lived in the 1800s, was an evangelist who directed the Ashley Down Orphanage in Bristol, England. He had literally in writing, documentation, 25,000 distinct answers to prayer. In fact, he wrote, and I quote, "Prayer is not overcoming God's reluctance, but it is laying hold of God's willingness." In fact, notice here Hebrews 4:16. "Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace," what, "with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." In other words, he's saying that we can approach the throne of grace with boldness. John says we can come confidently before God. When? Well, when we are followers of Jesus, when we know Christ as our Savior, when we're committed to his plan and his purpose. You can have confidence when you approach him in prayer. In fact, the truth is there's no such thing as an unanswered prayer. Now, I know when I say that, some of you say, Pastor, listen, I don't buy that. I mean, you may be like me. I mean, I prayed hard that the Sooners would beat LSU and eventually win the national championship last year. And Satan intervened and LSU won that game, right? So what am I saying? You know, you might be saying, I prayed and it didn't happen. Or maybe, hey, I prayed for my marriage and it didn't work out. I prayed for, you know, my grandmother and that she would get healed and she didn't. And so, Pastor, I have my list here to prove to you that there are unanswered prayer. Now, the problem with that line of thinking is that we then think prayer is answered when it's answered the way that we want it answered. In other words, what we're saying is, God, here's my shopping list, and if you don't come back with everything on it, then obviously you did not choose to respond. Now, we've talked about this many times. The fact is, anytime you pray, God answers, but he'll give you one of three answers. Sometimes God says yes. Sometimes God says you need to wait, not now. And sometimes God says no. Now, folks, the truth is, I mean, Abraham said, make Ishmael the son of promise. God said, nope. Well, Moses said, I want to go into the promised land. God said, no. David said, I want you to save the life of my son. God said, no. Jonah said, I want to go on a Mediterranean cruise. And look what happened to him, you know. So the fact is, we ought to pray for ourselves and others to know and discern and willing to follow God's will. Now, someone said it's kind of like a sailboat. The heart of sailing is simple. You've got to find the wind, and only when you find the wind can you feel yourselves and make your way. This is how we should pray. Searching God's will, seeking His face, looking for what God is doing, looking for what God is wanting, what His will is, and then join Him. That's why when you're talking about the will of God, first of all, we need to pray for spiritual clarity. Help me to know how to pray for my kids and family, and I need clarity. But number two, there's a second principle. I need to pray for spiritual courage. Pray for spiritual courage. It takes spiritual courage to not only know the will of God, but let me tell you what takes real courage, to do the will of God. Now, I use the word courage because it does just that. It takes courage in our day to live out and do the will of God. We need teenagers and students and adults who have the courage not just to know God's will, but the courage to do God's will. In fact, notice the way Paul put it here in verse 10. He said, so that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God. Now, it's interesting to me, Paul's prayer for them, it's interesting, he didn't pray for their success or their popularity or even their fulfillment, but his prayer is that they would live a life that pleased God, that they would know God's will and they would do it. Now, I want you to think about that. As you pray for others, what do you pray? Parents, as you pray for your kids, what do you pray? You know, a lot of times it's, well, you know, we pray for maybe their academic success or their athletic success or that they would succeed here, and all that's fine and good. But I want to tell you something. Ultimately, that's not going to, you know, that's not the answer. Ultimately, what you're asking is you pray that they would have a heart for God, that they would know God, that they would want to walk with God, that they would be committed to do His will. And He said, when that happens, what's happened? You're going to bear fruit. There's going to fruit that's going to come forth in your life. Now, when the Bible talks about fruit, it's usually two ways. One, it's often talking about like the fruit of the Spirit. In other words, Christ-like character, Galatians chapter 5, that we put on love, joy, peace, goodness, faith, temperance, those kind of things. And what happens is when you put on the character of Christ, you begin to look more like Jesus. And let me tell you, that's what spiritual maturity is. Spiritual maturity is not just how much you know, or how much of the Bible you can quote, or you know how knowledgeable you appear to be. Spiritual maturity is, are you becoming like Jesus? That's fruit, and that's a part of the fruit. So, you know, and the truth is, Jesus looks good in you, any life that's surrendered to Him. But there's another kind of fruit. It's the fruit of reaching out to others so that they would come to know Christ. See, God wants you to invest your life and not only knowing Him, but then sharing what you know with others, sharing the gospel, taking as many people with you into heaven as possible. He wants you to every day and in every way help your non-believing friends to take a step closer to Jesus. So let me ask you, are you reaching out? Maybe you've got a coworker, a friend, a family member that you can share that word of encouragement, reach out to help them take a step closer to Jesus. I love John Wesley's motto. He said, do all the good you can by all the means you can and all the ways you can and all the places you can at all the times you can to all the people you can as long as you ever can. Now, I think that's pretty good. That's pretty solid. But in this passage, he's talking about the fruit of the Christian life, this courage of obedience, that others would see the fruit of the life of Jesus by our good deeds and our service and our kindness. In fact, Jesus put it this way. John 15:8, He said, my Father is glorified by this, what? That you produce much fruit and prove to be my disciple. In other words, the way you prove that you're a follower of Jesus is that you produce fruit. Christ-like character. Your life makes an impact to others. You are walking obedience. You are fully surrendered to God's will and God's plan for your life. Now, I know that's easy to say. It's kind of one of those things that I used to think, oh, yeah, Lord, I think I really, I want your will more than anything else. And anytime I think back to that, I remember when I was at OBU. It was one of the last semesters I was at OBU, and there was a group of guys, and we would often pray together. And I had a friend that I got to know at OBU. He was from Korea. His name was Shiggy. We called him Shiggy. He loved the Lord, man. I mean, he was committed to Jesus. And so he would often come to this prayer time. Now Shiggy, some of the extended family that he had paid a high price for their faith in Jesus. I mean, when you talked about persecution, it was legit. I mean, literally putting your life on the line for your faith. And I'll never forget one time we're all praying together and we're kneeling here, and there's a guy on one side of Shiggy. Shiggy's right here. I'm right by him. There's another guy here. And so we're praying, you know, for God's will. And we have all these things we're praying for. And I keep thinking, yeah, Lord, I want your will. And I will always remember when Shiggy starts praying, I could just feel the passion in him. And I was up close to him. And then he started just praying things like, Lord, I lay my life to you. In fact, if persecution, I invite persecution. I invite suffering, whatever it is. I invite that into my, and I'm like, I don't know, you know. I remember thinking in my mind. And then I began to realize something. I'm not sure I'm as fully surrendered to God's will as he is. Because what he was really saying is, Lord, anything, bring it on. Your will through me, regardless of the cost. I was often saying, Lord, your will, as long as I get some benefits out of it. You know, here's my point. I'm not sure, because of where we live and we've been affected at some level by the prosperity gospel, that our tendency is to think, man, if I'm in God's will, then these are these benefits that I'm wanting. And yes, that often happens. But ultimately, a surrender to God's will is, Lord, I surrender to you regardless of the benefit. I mean, if none of the perceived benefits even happen, I'm following you. I'm surrendered to you. So whatever the price, I'm surrendered. And that's the courage of obedience. And then he goes a little bit further here. Not just the courage of obedience. Thirdly, pray for spiritual character. Spiritual character. Notice here verse 11. Being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience. Now, he's praying that we would not only know God's will with the wisdom to apply it and do it, but our lives would be consistent and faithful. In other words, that we would have a life of character and integrity. Someone said that integrity is integrating my heart values into my daily actions, that it is consistently living out in my daily actions what I say I believe. Now, it's interesting. Paul builds this around two words. He uses the word endurance and the words patience. Endurance is the ability to keep on keeping on. That's what endurance is. Patience is endurance in action. So in other words, he's not talking here about a Christian sitting in a rocking chair waiting on God to do something. What he's talking about, a Christian that is a soldier in the battlefield that will keep on when the going gets tough. Too many Christians compromise their integrity because they quit when it gets tough. There's a professor that I had that said, it's always too soon to quit. And Paul's basically saying here, it's not talent or training that guarantees the victory. It is endurance and it is patience. Spurgeon said, it is by perseverance that the snail reached the ark. So in other words, the test of our faith is more than just knowing the will of God, but it's in doing the will of God. And when you do the will of God, this is what he's saying. He's saying this Christ-like character will be reflected in your life. You're going to have integrity. So in other words, what you say you believe will be reflected in your life. People will look and say, that is a consistent person. That is a person who has endurance. That is a person who is faithful. And that will always be tested. In fact, in our midweek Bible study online, I told the story this week of four high school boys that were under the influence of spring fever. So they skipped school one spring morning and they showed up after lunch. And they blamed their tardiness on a flat tire. So when they showed up after lunch and they explained their reason to the teacher, and she gave them no protest, even with their excuse, they were shocked. They couldn't believe it. And so all she said to them was, listen, boys, that's great, but we took a test this morning, so you boys are going to have to take a test this afternoon. So you may as well get ready for it. So they said, okay. Well, she then put the boys in four corners of the room facing the corner and announced to them, there's only one question on this test. Which tire was flat? Well, folks, listen, the truth is every day is a test of character. I mean, who are you? What do you believe? How is it reflected in your life? Because here's the bottom line of his prayer. His prayer is that God would give them the knowledge of his will, the wisdom to live it out in courageous obedience, and it would be reflected in their lives through consistency and integrity. If you think about it, that's the power of the gospel unpackaged in your life and mine. Knowing his will, the wisdom to do his will, reflected our lives in a life of Christ-like character. See, when you see Jesus digging into the warehouse of the spiritual resources of the gospel, it comes then alive in us. And let me tell you the result. The result of a life of obedience is summed up in one word. It is the word gratitude. In fact, notice here this last verse in this prayer, verse 12. Joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. In other words, we are grateful because of the inheritance that we've received in Christ. You see, not only that he is the one who made us fit to share this incredible inheritance, because of his grace and the gospel, we know that we're going to heaven, but we also now share in this warehouse of spiritual resources to live life to the fullest. In other words, it's only in Christ that you can be all that you were created to be. I mean, do you realize that as a follower of Jesus? I mean, listen, we should have gratitude. Because if you know Christ, you've experienced firsthand God's amazing grace. Your sins have been wiped away. You've been given the assurance of eternity in heaven. You have been gifted by the Holy Spirit. You have the privilege of being placed in God's forever family. It would be an absolute insult to God to be that blessed and refuse to acknowledge it. The fact is, gratitude should be the character of our lives as followers of Christ. In other words, when others see your life or mine, is that what they see? I mean, that this gratitude because of this grace that's been extended to us from God, the new life that we have, gratitude should be reflected. And yet, sadly, far too many Christians look more like they've been baptized in pickle juice than they have really any sense of gratitude. A grumpy, negative, never satisfied Christian is an insult to God. But a Christian who joyfully gives thanks to God is pleasing to God. I read a few years ago about a Jewish lady's grandson. He was playing in the water and she was standing on the beach not wanting to get her feet wet when all of a sudden a huge wave appears from nowhere and crashes directly over the spot where the boy is waiting. Well, when the water recedes, the boy is no longer there. I mean, he just simply vanished. And she immediately holds her hands up to the sky and screams and cries, Lord, how could you? Have I not been a wonderful mother and grandmother? Have I not seeked to follow you? I mean, have I not tried my very best to live a life that you would be proud of? Well, a few minutes later, another huge wave appears out of nowhere, crashes on the beach, and as the water recedes, the boy is standing there smiling and splashing around as if nothing ever happened. A loud voice booms from the sky and says, Okay, I have returned your grandson. Are you satisfied? And she responds by saying, well, he used to have a hat. Well, folks, the truth is gratitude, I think, is hard for us. I think sometimes because we kind of have this entitled feeling. You know, well, things should go my way. Generally speaking, people should do what I want. This should be to meet my needs. This should be to make me happy. And my goodness, if it doesn't go that way, well, hey, we're going to throw a fit. And yet the truth is, Paul's saying that as a follower of Jesus, we should have this pervasive feeling of gratitude because God's done something for you that nothing can change. In other words, he has extended grace to you. He's called you into his family. You have been forgiven. You have the spiritual resources to live out the very purpose for which you were created. And you find that when you're willing to discern the will of God and have the courage to do the will of God, and that will then be reflected in your life of obedience. So let's pray to always remember the gift of God's undeserved grace. Because when you trust in Jesus and what he's done, he'll give you grace which will transform your life and eternity. Our hope is found in one person, and that is Jesus Christ. So I would encourage you, listen, to trust him today. If you haven't made that decision to trust Christ, maybe today you need to settle that in your heart and mind, the gift of eternal life that only Jesus can bring. Maybe it's a time to recommit your life. Maybe God's speaking to you about being a part of the Olivet family. Maybe there are other prayer needs that you have. Listen, we encourage you to respond as God speaks. Maybe you're joining us online and we want you to know if you have any prayer needs, you can actually text us to Olivet Pray to 81010. We'll respond to that. Also, if you want to respond to the gospel, just Olivet BC to 81010, and we'll respond to any questions that you have. But here this morning, as God speaks, I want to invite you to come. As every head bowed, every eye closed, just examining yourself. As you're here today and God's speaking to your heart, I don't know what decision you need to make. Maybe it's to trust Christ. Maybe it's to be a part of the Olivet family. But maybe there's other needs to pray about. But we're going to pray together. And as we stand and sing in a moment, I invite you to come. Father, we thank you for the good news of the gospel. We thank you for the hope that you've given us in Christ. And God, I pray this morning, anyone that's uncertain of their salvation, those this morning who may need to recommit their lives, those who may need to be a part of the Olivet family, other prayer needs, I pray that your will would be done in each heart and each life. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. As we stand together and sing, I want to invite you to come as God speaks.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on. Let us through his good will. He abides with us through, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but his blessing. Well, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and we hope that you'll take this message and use it and apply it to your hearts as you go to serve him the rest of this week. Before we are dismissed, we'll close in a word of prayer. Matt, would you dismiss us this morning?